Welcome to From Betrayal to Breakthrough, and here is a mini dose of Dr. Debbie where I'm sharing tips, suggestions, strategies, and sometimes just motivation to have you move past your betrayal once and for all. Hi there. So you know I'm always trying to bring you a new modality, process, tool, or thought leader, anybody or anything that can help you heal physically, mentally, emotionally, psychologically, spiritually from betrayal. And I have tried so many of these modalities myself. And usually what happens is if I try something and I like it, I usually get certified in it just because then I can understand it on a deeper level and I can help our members within the PBT Institute using this specific tool. Well, there's another one that I want to talk about today. And this is something that I do with our high-level Transform members. And I want to share it with you because I was like, you know, as great as this is for our Transform members, I want to offer it to any of you who feel like it may be a fit. So today I'm talking about a modality, a process, a methodology, and it's called human design. And if you're unfamiliar with human design, I'm going to give you the basics. If you're familiar with it, that's great too. But this is something that I find is very tied to betrayal. When you learn more about who you are and your specific design, there are areas where you can see where you may have aspects of your chart that could have it that why you're responding the way you are, why you're not doing certain things. Like it all shows up in the chart, which is so amazing. So I'm becoming kind of as certified in this modality as I can, because what I'm learning is the more I learn, the more I realize I don't know. And it's absolutely fascinating. So I'm taking this one all the way. Anyway, so we have a link to it. It's going to be the pbtinstitute.com/human design. If this feels like a fit, I would love to give you a reading. But right now, I want to share with you the very basics of it, so you have an understanding of what it is. And at the very least, you're going to feel such confirmation. You're going to feel such validation because so many things you've been doing are a part of your chart. So many things that you want to do but aren't doing, it's because you're not living according to your design. And it's all going to become clear as I share. So let's start with this. Human design is this compilation of these five things: the Chinese I Ching, astrology, the chakra system, Kabbalah, and quantum physics. So what happens is at the moment of your birth, everything gets locked in. That becomes your design. And your design doesn't change. Your chart doesn't change. How you express it, though, does. You could be living according to your human design and the higher expression of it, or based on prior conditioning, based on things that happened, based on a belief system, based on other aspects of your chart, you could be living in a way that isn't congruent with your chart. You could be living in a way that's more of a, like a misalignment. And when that's the case, you're not living your full potential and in a way that is just truly aligned. And that's when life becomes easy. And I know betrayal is one of the hardest things you're navigating and moving through. And as I explain this, I want you to see how possibly there may be aspects of your chart where if you knew what your human design was, you'd see how knowing even more would serve you. So there are so many parts to this. Like I said, I'm just going to give kind of a brief analysis, which is, you know, you could say of a brief overview of all of it. So the first thing is, and you may have heard this, there are types, and there are five types as it relates to human design. There's the manifester, the generator, the manifesting generator, the projector, the reflector. They're all good. So it's not like, oh, you're this, I'm jealous, I'm only this. No, no, no. Each type has its own brilliance to it. Each type is truly important in all of, you know, as it relates to humanity. We're all a piece of this puzzle here, and each is very much needed. But here's the thing. If one type tries to act like another type, they get in trouble. If one type is, you know, designed a certain way and another type isn't, and we're all conditioned to be the same, that's where we get into trouble. So real briefly, for example, if you know your type. Like I am what's called a manifesting generator. Now, a manifesting generator, and I want to show you, I'm going to use kind of my chart as an example so you see how incredibly perfect this plays out. One of the things with a manifesting generator is they're supposed to do a lot of things because they have a lot of energy. Now, all of the things they're doing, it's not like they're supposed to take all of them to completion. Some of them are just to use up their energy. So now if, think about this, if you were interested in many things and you grew up and someone in your world, your parent, whoever, said, just stick with one thing, right? You're actually not supposed to. So knowing that if this is your type and you're supposed to be doing many things and then you do, it's like, oh, wow, I'm actually living according to my design. Now, when I found out this aspect of you know, my chart, I was like, this is just the greatest thing ever. One of the things that a manifesting generator does, now, again, I don't know your design, so I'm just using mine as an example. One of the things that a manifesting generator does is they because they're so busy and because they do so much, they have a lot of energy, what happens is they can leave out some steps. And then they have to kind of go back and clean it up. And the whole reason for that is to find a shortcut. Well, wouldn't you know, the shortcut for me personally was the 5 stages from betrayal to breakthrough. That can literally save someone 20, 30 years of struggling in how to heal from betrayal. If you move through the 5 stages from betrayal to breakthrough, that is the shortcut. So right there, you see how perfect knowing what your type is and some of the aspects of it. Now, when I learned this one, and this is for many of the different types, this was so counterintuitive to anything I ever heard. I don't know, if you're like me, you have been taught, go out there and get it and hustle and keep trying and keep pushing and all of this. Well, I know I have hit that wall and I have been burned out many, many times because of overdoing it and pushing. And I mean, you may have heard that story here. It was 4 kids, 6 dogs, a business, like trying to make it all work. I mean, I was in so over my head, but I was conditioned to think no matter what, just keep pushing and making it happen. And it was so interesting to learn that a manifesting generator, and this is some of the other, many of the other types as well, they are supposed to react in response to something. Now, if you notice in your own experience, think about this, if this is you, you're pushing, you're trying, nothing's working. You feel like you're, you know, just going against the grain of all of it. And it's just, it's a struggle, right? But then have you ever noticed in your own experience, somebody suggests something to you, you get wind of something, an idea, somebody, you're having a conversation, and then all of a sudden you have energy like no other, and you just absolutely move so quickly and do this absolute perfect thing for you at the moment. That's acting in response to, and that's what you're actually supposed to be doing. And it gets even a little more extreme, I guess you can call it, like with if you're a projector, let's just say, not only are you supposed to kind of act in response to, you have to wait to be invited. So think about this. If you find you're a projector, for example, where you're offering your brilliance and it's just not being met, it's just not well received. But meanwhile, so there's this bitterness, right? You could be bitter, like, wait a second, my advice is great. Why doesn't anybody want to hear it? And then when you're invited and you share, it's the most brilliant thing ever. So you see, if you know what your design is, it can really help in how you go about things. Now, there's another part of this too, which is so important because it's the way you're supposed to make your decisions. And this was another thing. When I learned this, this was a game changer. The way my design is that I am never supposed to make decisions on the spot. If something feels like the greatest idea ever, I'm actually supposed to wait. And I'm supposed to wait, whether it's 24 hours, 48 hours, until I know for sure it's a good thing. Well, I didn't know that. And if I tell you, something would feel like an amazing idea, or seem like a great thing, I would buy it, say yes to it, sign off on it, and then I would wake up the next morning and completely regret it, or dread it, or wonder, what in the world was I thinking? Why did I say yes to that? Well, if I only knew this aspect of my design, I would have waited, right? But instead of that, I didn't, and I just said yes to something, went along with it because I was influenced or swept up in the moment, and then I regretted it. So think of how, if this is you, how that would change things for you. Instead of when you're thinking, you know, let's bring it back to betrayal now, as you're healing from betrayal and something feels right, what if it's not? What if you gave it that 24 or 48 hours? And if it consistently felt right, then it's different. But if it changed or if it wavered, how about if that's your clue that that's a no? Do you see how that could help you? Now, there are other types, and this is why knowing your type is important. There are other ways people respond to things where if they get this sort of intuitive hit, like this is a yes, then it is. And they can trust that. But let's say for someone like me, I can't trust that at all. That's not, because in the moment it feels like a yes, but it may change. So just that one thing can be so helpful. So that's just that. Now we also have these numbers, and it's your profile, and there's this conscious number and this unconscious number. And really it's sort of just gives, again, more of an idea of who you are. And I am giving you like so the Cliff Notes version of this. But for example, there are these six numbers. So if you're a one, that means you do the work, you do the research on something. Now, I don't have this one in my profile. So if I know you're a one, and let's say I'm looking for a refrigerator, and I know you're a one, I'm going to ask you, because you did the research and you're going to know. And I can feel really comfortable knowing you did the research. You are so solid with that. What you chose, I'm good with it, right? So that's the researcher. Two, you need alone time and you need a lot of it. Now think about this. If you didn't know that, you could feel guilty for pulling away from your partner or friends or your kids even, because you need this alone time. Or someone in a relationship with you, let's just say, could be insulted, right? But if you know this is who you are, it's part of what gives you that ability to be refreshed, you know, nourished, so you feel like you can come back stronger. You see, the number three, here's where you experiment a lot and you try a lot of things, and it's so that it's just part of who you are. And if you didn't know this about yourself, you could be really down on yourself. Why can I just not stick with one thing? Why do I keep bouncing around? Why am I never satisfied with one thing? But you see, you're not supposed to. So this is, let's say you're the type of person who hasn't stayed in one career from, you know, the time you were able to start working till the time you retire. You're not supposed to. Right? And that's all good. But when you know this about yourself, it's very freeing. It's very liberating. It's very validating. The four is a networker. The four has their relationships are really, really important. And that's also the place where they get the support to make big decisions. So if this is you, know that your people are really super important to you. Now, also there's something interesting about the four. The four doesn't like the unknown. Right. I mean, I don't know if many people do, but when I learned this, like I'm a four, and think about what betrayal does to, let's say, a four, right? The unknown. Oh my gosh, the rug has just been completely pulled out from under me. I have no idea what's next. This is a very scary place, right? So it's just for the four, and for everybody, but this is an aspect of the four that's particularly challenging. The five is the karmic mirror. So here, you know, you're bringing these beautiful, amazing insights and ideas and solutions, but it may not always be well received. So think about this. It's easy to take things personally, but it really has nothing to do with you. You see, you may be showing somebody who they are, and they're unwilling or not ready to see it. Then there's the six. The six is called The Role Model. And this was another one of those things. When I learned that I was the six, this just hit in such a beautiful way. The six actually has these three stages. The first is from birth to 30, and they're sort of acting like a three. A lot of experimenting to see, do I like this? Do I not like this? What works? What doesn't work? And then there's this period of time. It's called being on the roof. And here's where you're assessing and assimilating and figuring things out during this period of time. And then from 50 on, it's where you're walking the walk. You're talking the talk and sort of the role model with what you've assessed and assimilated and put together based on everything you've learned. Well, if I tell you at like 50 years old, probably, you know, to the day almost, that's when all of this betrayal insight and the ideas and the study and PBT and the TEDx talks, the books and the certification programs all emerged after 50. So here was another example of how brilliantly my chart showed me how perfectly aligned this was. And it was true. You also have these centers, and the centers are sort of like the chakra system, where there are different energies where you have according to where these centers are. Now, they can either be defined, meaning they're colored in on your chart, and that means you have consistent access to energy in that area, or they could be clear and undefined, meaning you take in and amplify the energy in that area. So this is another one of those things. For example, if you have an open, undefined emotional solar plexus, for example, you are taking in and amplifying the energy in that area. So if you were maybe told, oh my gosh, you're so overly sensitive, or you're so emotional, or this or that. Well, very often, if you have an open emotional solar plexus, that energy wasn't even yours. You were taking it in and amplifying the energy of that area. So do you see how understanding who you are is just so important? There's another center, the spleen, not the organ, it's the center. And here, one of the aspects of the spleen, the open spleen, is that you hang on to things too long. Now, for many of you who had a betrayal experience or more than one, and who know this is not in my best interest, wouldn't it be interesting if one of the aspects of your chart is this part of your chart that has you holding on to things for too long, right? It could very likely be. There are so many parts of the chart that tell so much, but I'm just giving you like the briefest overview. Again, every center tells a different story, has a different energy there. And here's the thing too. This is something I found so fascinating. There's the will center. And I was so insulted when I learned I didn't have a fixed, consistent energy in that area, because I thought, oh, I have amazing willpower. Well, I do if I really, 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 really try, but I also really, really, really burn myself out because I push too hard. Another aspect of the chart as well. But anyway, if you like, for example, if you have an open will, and let's say you're spending time with someone with a defined will, well, you may feel so motivated and so inspired. But here's where you don't want to commit to something right then, because what may happen is you're feeling motivated because you're picking up the energy from them. But then you leave them and you're thinking, I don't want to do that thing, right? I don't want to. Why did I say that? So for example, let's just use this example. If you're supposed to wait on making your decisions, right? And you don't have fixed, consistent, aspects of this willpower, and someone has this energy and this willpower, and it sounds like a good idea at the time. Can you see how that would work against you? Because now you've committed to something you don't have the energy for. You don't even want to do it. You should have waited. You see, but again, it all depends on your chart. Every center tells such an amazing story. There are also these gates And gates are conscious and unconscious. And the gates, that says a whole bunch of things too, where you have, it's more of a stronger theme for you if you have certain gates. And as I'm learning, and I've been taught so far, everybody has everything in the chart. It's just how it's expressed. But you know, with these gates, it's sort of fixed, consistent access to this particular energy. Like, for example, one of my gates is the gate 19, and that happens to make it that I'm highly sensitive. Well, I knew that, but having this confirmation was so beautiful. And also it shows that I love animals and I love nature. And it's so funny because here I had these six dogs. I love being in nature. So now imagine, like, let's just say you have that gate and you grew up craving animals and craving nature, and you denied yourself because someone in your world thought it was a bad idea or whatever. Can you see how you may not be living according to your design? And if you then, let's say this is the case for you, then you did get a pet or you were out in nature and it felt so good, you would live more authentically to who you are. So again, knowing these gates are so helpful. Also, there are channels. Channels are, it's when a gate meets another gate, it becomes a channel, and it actually defines the both of the centers that each gate connects to. So if one gate meets up with another gate and it becomes a channel, then both of those centers that they're connected to become defined. Again, this just means that there are these stronger themes that you have. And it's again, fascinating. We'll use my chart as an example. You could see in my chart how I would be a speaker. You can see in my chart how I'm an author. You could see in my chart how people love telling me their stories, knowing they can feel safe because it's not going anywhere past me. And it's so interesting because I hear that all the time. People will say to me, I can't believe I just shared this with you. I haven't said, and I've never told this to anybody. And it's actually in my chart why people feel that way. So it's so fun just to see when you're living according to your chart. And again, when you're not, life becomes harder and it doesn't feel as congruent. It feels like you're just exerting more effort all the time. So channels, again, so I'm giving you the Cliff Notes version, everybody. Circuits. This is another thing. And we have individual circuitry. We have tribal circuitry. We have the more of a collective circuitry. And really what this means is you have energy for as an individual, things that you need to learn to learn and master and become stronger in. And then there are things that you're doing for the tribe, you know, for the, whether that's your family or your people in your circle, people that you love, where you're really going, your strength and your love is in helping those in your circle. And then of course there's things that you're doing for the greater good. We usually have a mix of all three. And it expresses in such different ways, but even something like codependency, you could see that in the chart. It's just amazing. So that's circuitry. And then there's something so interesting too, and it's called the incarnation cross. And this is, it's something that sort of summarizes who you are. Well, again, when I learned what my incarnation cross was, it was just so brilliant. And so much of this also has to do with the astrology piece, where it changes according to how, you know, because the planets move and they shift, and how does that impact your chart as well? But just getting back to that incarnation cross, this was so fascinating too. It was sort of like when you know what yours is, then you're like, oh wait, am I living like this or am I not? But when I learned that mine was, and it was said and stated so much more beautifully than what I'm going to share, but it was something like how I'm meant to share a message of self-love and empowerment. And, my lessons are through relationships and healing and love and forgiveness and, and connecting. And I mean, it was so much better than that. But when you look at what I'm doing, isn't that so perfect? Here I am. My greatest lessons have been learned through relationship, right? Healing from betrayal. You don't do that on your own. It's not because of something that, you know, self-betrayal, of course, but you know what I'm talking about. So here it is, learning my greatest relationships, my greatest lessons through my relationships, and learning and then sharing what happens when you rebuild yourself, how you become so loving to yourself because you realize all you've been through and you give yourself that dose of kindness and care and love, that sense of empowerment because you realize how strong you are and how courageous you are and all you can do with it. And it was, again, just so obvious when I learned this. So again, I wanted to share human design with you because it's another tool, another modality that can potentially share with you more about who you are, why you do the things you do, how you operate, and if you're not living according to your design, how life can be a whole lot simpler. So I hope you enjoy this tool as much as I do. And like I said, just you could go to the site, thepbtinstitute.com/human design. If you want a reading by me, like I said, I am studying this. I'm currently at level 4 right now. I am taking this as high as I can because it's something that pairs so beautifully with healing from betrayal. It's just another beautiful tool. And of course, so many other resources out there to try as well. But I wanted to give you a Cliff Notes version of what this is and what it can do for you. I hope it helps you, even if it just gives you a way of making healthier decisions. Think about that, how that would impact you. But it can do that and so much more. So I hope you found this episode interesting. And I will be back next week with a new tool, modality, strategy, something that's going to help you move physically, mentally, emotionally, psychologically, spiritually through betrayal. I'll see you next time.
You need the right tools, support, and the right community to move through the 5 stages from betrayal to breakthrough. And we have all that within the PBT Institute. So join us at the PBT, as in post-betrayal transformation, thepbtinstitute.com. There's a version of you who's so confident, healthy, peaceful, and happy on the other end of your healing. And we can't wait to help you get there. We got you. Thanks for listening. And here's to your breakthrough.